architect Meera Milan Ajit. She's currently working as a senior architect at L&T Construction, Buildings and Factories. She has worked for various commercial and institutional projects for the Engineering Design Research Center, ranging from shopping malls, IT parks to metro rails. She has attended many national conferences and seminars. She has also worked as a freelancer in Chennai for various projects.
Welcome to UGC Lecture Series in Architecture. I will now be taking you through Earthquake Resistant Architecture, that is AR6008. Lecture 7. So basically, like in the previous lectures, what I mentioned, it's always better to be prepared, be aware and be ready whenever an earthquake strikes. That is the purpose and the reason why we are learning this particular subject, to understand how to tackle an earthquake and what kind of construction materials and techniques has to be followed in order to design a building that might be completely or partially or actually fully resistant to the earthquake. In the previous lectures, we saw what is an earthquake, what are the various terminologies that was associated with the earthquake, like epicenter, how and when would the earthquake act, and if an earthquake act, what are the basic impacts that is that follows it, what are the various what are the various attributes of an earthquake? How and when? How does a particular building react when an earthquake strikes? We also learned the various construction technologies that we follow for certain types of buildings, what are the basic construction faults of the particular types of buildings when an earthquake strikes, and what are the measures that has to be taken in order to make that particular building earthquake resistant. Moving on to this particular lecture, that we would be seeing part 3 of the unit 4, that is the various types of construction details like I mentioned before. So talking about the contents of this particular lecture, the first and foremost thing that we are seeing now is a seismic design and detailing of non-engineered construction, that is wood structures. So talking about wooden structures, in this particular lectures we would be seeing the introduction, the typical characteristics of wood, typical structural properties of wood, the building plan that has to be followed for a wooden structure. Moving on, the next thing that we would be seeing in this particular lecture is the seismic design and detailing of the non-engineered construction, that is the earthen structures. So in the earthen structures, again we will be going through an introduction of the earthen structures and what are the various types of earthen structures, typical damage and collapse of earthen buildings, typical structural properties of the same, the building plan that has to be followed, the classification of earthen construction, and the suitability of soil. These are the various contents of this particular unit, and moving on to the first and foremost part of this unit is the seismic design and detailing of wooden structures. So basically, why are we learning about the wooden structures? Why? What is the basic importance of understanding about the construction details of wooden structures? When you go to certain parts of the world, there are like many earthquake prone areas wherein wood is definitely used as the major material of construction. Therein, that is the most naturally available material there. That is the vernacular construction techniques there. So there are many places where wood is used as the major form of construction, for which it's very important for us to understand how to tackle wood and how to go about constructing wooden structures and yet make it earthquake resistant. So wood has higher strength per unit weight and is therefore very suitable for earthquake resistant construction. So, but heavy cladding walls could impose high lateral load on the frame. Although seismically suitable, use of timber is declining in building construction even when it's used to be prevalent material on account of vanishing forest due to population pressure. So basically, even though wood is considered to be a very strong material, nobody knows the basic value of wood against earthquake resistant construction. So wood definitely is a very suitable material for the earthquake resistant construction, and so there are many things that we have to follow in order to keep wood acting positively towards the earthquake and still resisting the earthquake load. Timber buildings may only be used in those areas and countries where it is still abundantly available or in unavoidable situations only. Some construction details only differ for hollow blocks, which are also indicated as necessary. So, the typical features of earthquake damage to wooden buildings are as follows. The roof tiles easily slide down during earthquakes. If they are not properly fastened to the roof, falling roof tiles may hurt people. So, basically this particular picture shows you how a wooden roof tiles might actually fall off during earthquake, and so that can be one of the major reasons. So, basically as in previous lectures that I told you, the major things that affect the human life in an earthquake is falling of structures or dismantling of structures on them. So, one major thing that might hurt them in the wooden structure is the falling of roof tiles. So, the failure of joints connecting the columns and girders frequently occurs in wooden structures, accompanying the falling of finishes one by one. So, as the inclination of building increases, its restoring force against the distortion decreases due to the structural deterioration in roof weight, and finally that becomes negative, which results in the complete collapse of the building. So, then a perpendicularly standing building, when a building inclines, so that kind of gives rise to a structural failure, because the strength of the building or the roof kind of diminishes as it goes slanting. So, that way it one by one, once one thing collapses, everything will collapse one by one. So, as you can see in the picture, you can see that there might be a rupture of columns that connects the brace, and at the end this will fall, all three of them will fall one by one and ruptures and fall on people, and that might cause disruption. Again, here you can see the rupture of columns due to large notching at the connection of the girder and the column. So, basically, as you can see, the slanting of this particular this thing is more. So, that kind of creates a rupture at the corner which connects all three parts of the building, and that kind of breaks the whole building. Moving on. So, in the case of two-story buildings, the first story usually suffers severer damage than the second story. It is often seen that the first story falls down while the second story is undamaged. So, if you can see in this particular picture, you can understand that the second story here is undamaged and the first story kind of gives up in the joints and kind of ruptures. So, damage is considerably influenced by the ground condition on which the building stands. In general, the softer the subsoil, the severer the damage to the building. The damage due to differential settlement of foundation is also observed for buildings on soft ground. Sliding of the building as a whole is sometimes seen when there are no anchor bolts connecting to the sill to the foundation. So, basically the connection between the sill and the foundation is the basic thing that keeps the building standing. So, when an earthquake touches the building, if you can see the anchor bolts between the foundation and the sill is not perfect, then the whole building might as well slide. So, this, if you can see the picture, it shows the sliding due to insufficient connect between the sill and the footing. This is what happens. So, other types of damage in wooden buildings are failure of wooden gable frames and failure due to rupture of bottom cords of roof truss. So, the most crucial destruction of wooden buildings has been due to fire, resulting from electrical short circuit to kitchen fires during the earthquake shaking and spreading into configuration thereafter. Precautions against fire are more important in case of wooden buildings. So, if you can see, wood is very prone to fire. So, once a fire happens in a wooden building, it's almost impossible to contain it because it spreads really fast. So, usually as I discussed in the previous lectures, that there are so many aftermaths of the earthquake that can happen, and one of the major aftermath is the fire. So, once a fire happens, and if the building is wood, it's really difficult for it to contain. So, that is a major problem in a wooden building when it comes to earthquakes. So, in the coming lectures, you will see as to how and when the fire happens and how to contain it. So, if you can see in this particular picture, it shows the failure modes of the gable frame. So you can see that the earthquake force, that is one that happens to the particular frame, and you can see the joints here fail, and you, at the as a result of which the particular whole roof frame collapses. So once the earthquake touches here, this particular joint kind of moves away and it slips, based on which the roof that is sitting on top of it kind of tilts and the whole thing falls down. Again below you can see when the earthquake force acts, the whole thing completely falls down as one go to one side. So these are the two different types of failure of gable frame when earthquake strikes in a wooden building. So talking about the typical characteristics of wood. Wood is a non-homogeneous and anisotropic material, showing different characteristics not only in the directions but also in tension and compression. Shrinkage of wood on dying is relatively large. So particularly the joints slacks easily by contraction in the direction perpendicular to the fibers. Therefore, dry wood shall be used and moisture content should be less than 20%. So once the moisture content increases more than 20%, the scare against the earthquake kind of increases. So, it kind of is more prone to fall off and give up structurally. So, the elastic modulus is small, consequently the members are apt to show large deformation. A notable creep phenomenon is seen due to permanent vertical loads, and this is important especially in snowy areas. Shrinking occurs by compressive force in the direction perpendicular to fibers. This is a great influence through the amount of deformation of horizontal members and cot members of built members. The defects and notches of wood influence greatly in the strength and stiffness. Consequently, it's necessary to select and to arrange structural members considering their structural properties. Wood is easily decayed by repeated changes of moisture. Therefore, seasoned wood should be used in construction. Preservative treatment is necessary to avoid rotting and insect attack on timber so as to derive long life. Wood is a combustible material, as I said before. Fire can easily affect wood. It's really, really difficult to contain the fire once it affects wood. Precautions must be taken to minimize the danger of fire. Long lengths more than 3.5 meter and large size timbers are difficult to obtain, hence call for splicing through connections of gluing. So, talking about the typical structural properties of wood, there are large varieties of timbers in use in various countries, as I mentioned before. It will therefore not be practicable to present their strength properties completely, but it will be pertinent to mention that these depend on number of factors as follows. So, basically the wood specimen matters, the direction of loading relative to the grain of wood matters. So, different types of wood will have different types of graining, and that kind of depends on the availability of wood in certain areas. So, based on the wooden grain, the direction of loading changes, and that affects the structural property of the wood. The defects like knots, checks, cracks, splits, shakes and veins, then the moisture content or seasoning, sapwood, pith wood from dead trees and dried wood conditions, location of use, that is inside protected, outside alternate wetting and drying. These are the major properties that affect the construction of wooden structures. If you can see, this is the failure due to rupture of bottom cord of roof truss. So, once force acts in the center, if you can see, basically the wall or column first of all ruptures. You can see in this picture, this is how from straight it kind of tilts to one side, and then after that the ties rupture, and at the end of it the roof truss completely falls down. So this second figure shows you completely exactly what happens after the rupture. One by one, once the column fractures, the truss and the tie automatically falls down. So, talking about the building plan of the wooden structures, the plan of the building should be surrounded and divided by bearing wall lines. The maximum spacing of the bearing wall lines should be 8 meters, not more than that. The maximum width of opening in the bearing wall line is 4 meters, and the opening is at least 50 centimeters away from the corner. Adjacent openings should be at least 50 centimeters apart. All bearing wall lines of the lower story should be supported by continuous foundations through sills, or the columns should rest on the pedestals. So, if you can see in this picture, the picture shows the plan divided by bearing walls like I said before. And also, this picture shows a stud wall construction of the wooden buildings. All bearing wall lines of the upper story should be supported by the bearing wall lines of the lower story, and the height of the building shall be limited to two stories or two stories plus attic, nothing more than that. So, that's why always when you see in wooden story construct, wooden building construction, the height of the building is restricted to one particular level, doesn't go beyond that. Moving to the next major part of this lecture, that is seismic design and detailing of non-engineered construction, that is earthen structures. Another major construction technique that we follow while making buildings is the earthen structures. There are many countries that still follow the same, and there are multiple types of construction in earthen structures. Basically, in wood and RC structures, if you can see, there is only one particular type of construction that we follow, but in earthen structures, there are multiple different types of earthen structures and the construction techniques that we follow. So, it is very important for us to understand that what are the basic implications of each type of earthen construction style, and what are the various factors that has to be considered while creating design strategies for earthen structures. So, earthen construction has been and is and will continue to be a reality. As I said, it still happens. Even though this material has clear advantage of cost, aesthetic, acoustics and heat insulation and low energy consumption, it also has some disadvantages such as being weak under earthquake forces and water action. So, once earthquake strikes or water action happens or liquefaction happens, the earthen buildings are the first one that usually gives up during this. So, even though the technology developed to date and has allowed a reduction in disadvantage of the earthen construction, stressing its most valuable advantages. So, basically what happened, the technology advanced and many construction technology had come, and based on what the disadvantages of the earthen construction has been reduced and many more advantages has been added. So, earthen constructions are in general spontaneous, and a great difficulty is the dissemination of knowledge about its adequate use. What are the typical damage and collapse of the earthen buildings? So, damage is always much more than severe in two-storied buildings and in one-storied buildings. So, once the as tall the building is, that much the damage would increase in earthen buildings. However, single-storied houses with flat roofs constructed in good clay have been found to be undamaged, whereas at the same location, two-storied houses were completely ruined. So, if you can see in this picture, the picture shows a typical damage and collapse of earthen buildings. So, basically, if you can see, the corner failure and out of plane collapse of walls that happens, and then the gables completely give up, and we are left with nothing but just four walls. In the two-story house, the damage is more. You can see the whole thing completely depletes and falls over. And also, sometimes when the split level roof is there, almost half of the roof is completely given off again, leaving us with just walls. Then you have the L-shaped building, wherein that's a different type of buildings that we have. In that, usually what happens in such buildings, the corners give up when the earthquake strikes, because it won't be really tight and well tied. So, that way the whole building comes completely depletes. So, in high walled houses again, the height is really more. As the height increases, it becomes more and more prone to earthquake. So, again, you can see the whole building depletes completely, and in awnings, the stiff and the shorter part mean as in stays, and the cantilevered part kind of gives up and depletes. So, talking about the graphic summary of the causes of failure, you can see that You can, this is a one or more story building that we are depicting here with a heavy roof tile. So basically there is deficient bond at the corners, continuous vertical joints, and the vertical joints won't have mortar, and that again is a problem. Then there's poor adobe quality without straw and poorly mixed mud. When the adobe construction, which we'll be seeing next, when in adobe construction the quality is not proper and the straw is not mixed well with the mud, then the construction failure happens. Again, lack of horizontal reinforcement, which is not there. In earthen buildings, there is no horizontal reinforcement or the less horizontal reinforcement. That kind of gives rise to depleting, the building falling due to earthquake. Then there is a lack of foundation and plinth, that might be another thing. Then the walls are way too high and too long. As I said before, it's as small the earthen buildings are that much stronger the buildings would be. So when the openings are too close to the corners, there are chances that, you know, it kind of ruptures at the corners. And when the openings, that the doors and windows are way too large, there won't be any horizontal member which supports it. So kind of that much area, there won't be any support around it, in that area it might rupture. The classification of earthen constructions. So there are like two major classification, that is hand formed by layers and adobe or blocks. In the hand formed by layer, there is simple flaming, earth balls thrown and molded as wall. And then in adobes or blocks, you have cut from hardened soil, formed in mould or moulded and compacted. Then we have the tapial or pice, that is rammed earth construction, that's very common. So in that we have the compact, that we have construction compacted by hand blocks, mechanical or vibrating compaction, that is basically previously the construction was just compacted by hand blows. Later, as the technology advanced, mechanical or vibrating compaction started coming in. That kind of became another construction technique. Then we have a wood or cane construction with wood or cane mesh enclosures plastered with mud. So you have the continuous structure and prefabricated panels, wherein you make the panel somewhere else and then you bring it and then fix it on site and then put mud over it. That also happens. So, talking about the suitability of soil, the quality of materials, particularly clay content of the soil, may vary somewhat for the type of construction, but in general, the following qualitative tests are sufficient for determining the suitability of a soil for earthen construction. So, the first test that we conduct is for this is the dry strength test. So, what happens in this particular test is, 5 or 6 small balls of soil, approximately 2 centimeter in diameter, are made. Once they are dry, after 48 hours, each ball is crushed between the forefinger and the thumb. So, if they are strong enough that none of them break, the soil has enough clay to be used in adobe construction. And if some of the balls break, the soil is not considered to be adequate because it does not have enough clay and should be discarded. So, basically in adobe construction, the major factor that we consider is the clay quantity of the soil. So, if after 48 hours of the balls being made and then crushing between your forefinger and the thumb, when you press it, if it doesn't break, then that means that passed the dry strength test. Next is the fissuring control test. So, at least 8 sandwich units are manufactured with mortars made with mixtures in different proportions of soil and coarse sand. So, the sandwich having at least the least content of coarse sand, when opened after 48 hours, does not show the visible fissures in the mortar, will indicate that the mortar most adequate proportion of soil sand for adobe construction, giving the highest strength. The next is a strength test of adobe. So, the strength of adobe can be qualitatively ascertained as follows. After 4 weeks of sun drying the adobe, it should be strong enough to support in bending the weight of a man. If it breaks, more clay and fibrous materials to be added. So, for adobe construction, as I mentioned before, you use clay or other fibrous materials in clay in order to make. So, once that is made and blocks are made and you dry that for 4 weeks in sun, and you bring that, and when if it cannot handle the weight of one man, then we need to add more materials to make it strong and then as it mold it again. So this picture shows the different field testing of strength of solid soil and adobe. If you can see, this is the dry ball test. As I said, you have you make the dry ball of 2 cm diameter and then you compress it between your fingers, and you can see if it doesn't break and still like this, then that means it passed the test. And here is it, this is the testing of adobe strength. As I said, if it breaks, if after 4 weeks of making a mold, and if it doesn't, it breaks under a man's weight, then that means it is poor. And if it doesn't, then that means it's good and you can just go ahead and construct with it. So this is the good features of earthquake resistant construction, as you can see. So basically, you should have only one story and attic, that is the best one. So you need to use sheeting as roof materials or cement tiles. You need good bond in the wall, that is it shouldn't be the bond between the wall should be strong. Then you need to use a plinth, that is 30 centimeters minimum plinth should be given. You need to use collar beam below the roof beam trusses. You need to use horizontal reinforcements, which is very, very important because that kind of gives strength to the structure. You need to have good bond between adobe and alternate vertical, good joint quality of adobe. And in rainy areas, roof projects at minimum 50 centimeter and waterproof plaster should be there on the wall. The openings should be minimum 1.2 meters away from the corners, and the low walls maximum 8 times thicker. So there should be damp proofing at the plinth in order to avoid liquefaction in case of earthquake, and small door and window openings should be at the good location of the house. Moving on to the summary of this particular lecture. In this lecture, we learned about the seismic design and detailing of non-engineered construction like wooden and earthen structures. We learned about the various damages in wooden structures, typical characteristics of wood and typical design solutions. Also, we learned about the different characteristics of earthen structures, damages on the same and design solutions. So, moving on to the questions. Explain in detail about the seismic design and detailing of wooden structures. What are the typical properties of the wooden structures? Explain in detail about the seismic design and detailing of earthen structures. What are the characteristics of earthen structures? Illustrate the good features of earthquake resistant construction. Elaborate the suitability of soil. Thank you. In the coming lectures, we would be going through some other forms of construction and the earthquake resistance to that construction and the construction practices of the same. We would also learn about certain implications of earthquake and also about the restoration of the earthquake resistant structures. Thank you.